Welcome to the St. Peter Lutheran Church. All right, it's going to be one of those mornings. Steve's going to get me a new headset soon, though, right? All right. Lord willing. Okay, maybe some people don't want that. I don't know. Good morning again. We have several friends and visitors today because Al's birthday is being celebrated today. He's going to be 90 on Wednesday. So he's not quite there yet, and we know he looks pretty healthy this morning, so I think he's going to get there. So unless he gets out of line and Marilyn has to knock him down a peg, I don't know. But they've provided some treats for us in the basement, and we've got several people visiting who are friends and family, and so encourage you to fellowship with one another and enjoy that time and celebrate the long life that Al's had in our community and with our church here. Several different things today. I knew it was coming up soon because it was postponed last year, and it was on the day that we came to visit. The Delmont Sausage Feed, or what's the official title? I don't know, it's just the Delmont Sausage Day, basically. Yeah, it's today from 11 to 6. So if you didn't already know that, and I just found out this morning, but it's from 11 to 6 today. So, and you don't have the weather as an excuse this year. It was a little chilly last year when we went, but it was still good. So encourage you to go out there and support the firefighters and the community. Fly group will be singing with Steve and meeting with him after the Sunday school opening today to prepare for Easter. Greeting cards, contact Sandy, probably give her some money, I would assume. Yeah, money? No money, just orders? Oh, okay, pay later. Yeah, make a big order now. It's like Christmas, right? We need to get all this stuff. And then the bills come the next year, and you're like, oh, okay, whatever. this is coming from a guy who doesn't send cards. You know how that goes, right? Oh, why do I feel like there was so much more to talk about? The men are singing tonight. So if you don't have anything going on this evening and you like good music, I've got roped into the Dakota Jubilee men's group. Yeah, whatever. You chorus me. And there's a few of us from the congregation that sing in that group. It's fun if you like guys singing, which it sounds really good. It sounded really good last night when you practiced. That's at Tripp High School, and that's tonight at 7 p.m. So go stuff your faces with sausage, and then after you've had a little nap or whatever, you can come out to Tripp and watch the guys sing. And free will offering, so there's not really a cost to come. And so come and enjoy that. Four different groups singing. And then they'll sing individually, and then they all sing together. And it sounded good last night, so hopefully it sounds good today. Lent is upon us, so I encourage you to come out for Ash Wednesday. That'll be this Wednesday. I know the other thing I was supposed to say. Men who come to the men's breakfast, I will be leading you this time. That's the first, because Tim's been doing a great job finishing up our discipleship program. So I'll be leading for this first time. And as usual, you have 2 weeks to figure out who's going to feed us. So if you feel the urge to cook breakfast that morning, I invite you to let somebody know so we stop asking people who's going to cook this time around. And it always works out, they tell me, and so far it has. So hopefully that continues with me taking over now. Any other announcements or anything else we need to know from the congregation? Yep, Donna? Oh, yeah, whose birthday is it? Is it Jeremy's? Oh, hiding there behind Josh. Yeah. Let it be known for the record, Jeremy, I didn't point it out. So Alma will take care of that downstairs later, I'm sure, right? On the plus side, Jeremy, stand next to Al and you'll look years younger. Not Al doesn't look old, but sorry, I didn't mean that to come as a dig against Al. But Al is older in years. He's more mature, wiser. A wiser man, right, Al? Yeah. Oh, goodness. All right. Hey, at least the bell has a rope and nothing else is going to go wrong today, right? With that, I invite you to please stand as you are able. And we'll open with our call to worship. I will do a call to worship from here because I don't want to crackle in the ears right now. And then I'll step up there for opening prayer. We read responsively together from Psalm 2. As for me, I have set my king on Zion, my holy hill. Ask of me, and I will make the nations your heritage, and the ends of the earth your possession.
You shall break them with a rod of iron, and dash them to pieces like a potter's vessel.
Now therefore, O kings, be wise. Be warned, O rulers of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear, and rejoice with trembling. We continue with prayer to the Lord. Father, we thank you for this gorgeous day today. We thank you for the beautiful days that we've had lately, and we ask you continue to bless and protect us this spring. Lord, as we come together this morning and celebrate and worship you, we also celebrate life and the recognition of some birthdays and long lives here. And just the fact that we woke up today is such a gift and a blessing that sometimes we take for granted, Lord. And so we come to you this morning thankful. We come to you this morning with humble hearts as we bow down before you. And we ask that you serve us this morning, Lord, as you promised to. Through your worship and through music and through your word, we ask that you minister to our hearts and our minds and our souls this morning. Where there is brokenness, we ask that you repair and heal. Where we are doing well, we ask that you encourage us and strive to build into us a mission and a work. And where things are just ordinary and normal, Lord, we ask for you to help us to see the joy in each day and to bring a new excitement of worshiping and following you and looking forward to Lent and Easter and celebrating what you did for us on the cross. So this morning I ask that, Lord, you open our hearts and minds, that we are prepared to receive you this morning, and that we are prepared to return back to you as well some service and joy as our thank offering to you. All these things we pray in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. You may be seated. We continue with our opening hymn, O For a Thousand Tongues to Sing. Let us bow before the Lord and confess our sins to him. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess to you that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. Therefore, we flee for refuge to your infinite mercy and ask you, for Christ's sake, grant us forgiveness of all our sins, and by your Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of you and of your will, and true obedience to your word, to the end that by your grace we may come to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As much as for you, our declaration of grace from God. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, has had mercy upon us and has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake he forgives us all our sins. To those who believe on his name, he gives power to become sons of God and has promised them his Holy Spirit. He who believes and is baptized shall be saved. Grant this, Lord, to us all. Amen. You may be seated as we continue with our song, I Know Whom I Have Believed. Thank you.
The first reading comes from Exodus 24, verses 8 through 18. And Moses took the blood and threw it on the people and said, "Behold the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with all these words." Then Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel went up. And they saw the God of Israel. There was under his feet, as it were, a pavement of sapphire stone, like the very heaven for clearness. And he did not lay his hand on the chief men of the people of Israel. They beheld God and ate and drank. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and wait there, that I may give you the tablets of stone with the law and the commandment, which I have written for their instruction." So Moses ran with his assistants Joshua and Moses went up into the mountain of God. And he said to the elders, "Wait here for us until we return to you. And behold, Aaron and Hur are with you. Whoever has a dispute, let him go to them." Then Moses went up on the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. The glory of the Lord dwelt on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days. And on the seventh day, he called to Moses out of the midst of the cloud. Now the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on the top of the mountain in the sight of the people of Israel. Moses entered the cloud and went up on the mountain, and Moses was on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights.
The second reading comes from 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 16 through 21. For we did not follow clearly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For when he received honor and glory from the God the Father, and the voice is borne to him by the majestic glory, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." We ourselves heard this voice, very, very voice born from heaven, for we were with him on the holy mountain. And we have the prophetic word more fully confirmed, to which we will do well to pay attention as to a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts, knowing this first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. For no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God, as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit.
Please rise as you're able. We continue with our gospel reading this morning. Our gospel lesson comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 17, beginning with verse 1, the transfiguration of our Lord. And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. And Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good that we are here. If you wish, I will make 3 tents here, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah." He was still speaking when, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell on their faces and were terrified. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Rise and have no fear." And when they lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. And as they were coming down the mountain, Jesus commanded them, "Tell no one this vision until the Son of Man is raised from the dead." Here ends our gospel lesson. Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and is seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy
congregation may be seated. Invite our ushers to come forward for our offering. Father, we come before you thankfully offering back to you the things that were yours to begin with, that you were just offering to us as things that we could steward and manage and take care of. And so as we return them to you, we release them to you for you to use them as you see fit and for the furthering of your name and your glory. That includes not just our money and our financial resources, Lord, but also our time and the gifts of talents and abilities that you've given us as well. Help us to put them to use with your control and your will and desire rather than our own. Help us to submit them to you, our whole selves, all of our time, that it is all a gift. Even this day that you've given to us, Lord, let us use it to the best that we can to glorify you and to love others as you have commanded us. Lord, as we come before you, there are many on our minds that we do have love and care for, Lord, that we want to bring to you and have you take care of their needs and their problems and their struggles, maybe ourselves as well. We think of physical things that limit us and hold us back, and we have young children who are just growing and learning and maturing and learning how to use their physical bodies and the minds that you've given them. We ask, Lord, that you help develop those bodies and minds. Help the parents and the grandparents and the communities to raise the children up in ways that are honoring to you and to others, to value themselves as a creation of you, as beings that and individuals that are not junk but are made and glorified for you, Lord. We ask that you give each of us that sense and reminder that we are a creation of you, and every one of your creations is loved and intentionally molded and given a purpose. So, Lord, we ask you to reveal your purpose to us today for each and every one of us. We're so thankful for those who we celebrate this morning. We're thankful for Al and Jeremy and the long lives that you've given them so far, Lord. And we ask you to continue to bless their lives, bless their families, their friendships. The world is a better place for the people you've placed into it. And these are two examples that we can be thankful for in our church and in our communities who do so many things for others selflessly and sacrificially as farmers and as fathers and husbands and just as neighbors and as a veteran. And we thank you for the things and that they've done through the years and that will continue to do for others and for you. And we ask that we do likewise, Lord. And we are thankful for those who are following your will and your footsteps that way. And Lord, we ask you to heal those who are hurting or struggling. We're thankful for modern technology and surgery that can replace knees. We've had a couple members recently who've had knee replacements. What a glorious thing that we can do things like that with our bodies. We have people who have heart technologies that allow them to live today that they couldn't have lived years ago. We're thankful for that. The work of the doctors and the skills that you've provided and knowing when to go to the doctor and get assistance, Lord, that they might help make our lives better and more comfortable so that we can work harder and with more joy and less stress. These are gifts from you. Let us not take them for granted, Lord. Lord, I ask that you give wisdom to us, but more especially to our leadership, our local leadership, our government in the state and in our nation and in the world as well, with the various things we hear in the news that we as humans need to try to manage and try to deal with and react to. And we ask, Lord, for wisdom that comes from you rather than serving dollars or power. Lord, as we complain perhaps about the leaders that we have or the election process we go through and the so many ideas and thoughts and actions which are not glorifying of you, as we complain about those things, Lord, let us rather turn our complaining into preaching and professing what is the right thing, what is the correct thing, what is your will, what is your desire. And we get that from your word. We get that from the teaching of Jesus Christ to us as his disciples. Only when your wisdom is prevalent can the wisdom that of man that fails be removed and changed and corrected. And so give us a boldness in our hearts and in our mouths to speak the truth and to confront wrong ideas with the truth and the right ideas of your wisdom. Embolden us in that, but also let us do it with love. That when we are sharing the truth, let it bring a greater flavor and richness to the world. That they can see that the truth brings life and that lies and falsehood bring death and disease. So help us in that today, Lord. Lord, there are so many things on our hearts and minds that we can't always express, or maybe we're not able to yet express publicly. We ask you, Lord, in this moment of silence, you hear our heart, hear the groanings of our heart. Remove these burdens from us. And Lord, we thank you that you are a God of relationship, that you are a God and creator who desires to know his creation. And so when we come to you and we pray to you, we know you listen. We know you hear us. And you may not answer the way that we desire, but you always answer in the way that is right and true and faithful to your promises and your wisdom and message to us, your hope that you give us. And so thank you for that. All these things we thank you and praise you and bring to you in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated. We continue with our hymn, Be Thou My Vision, O Lord of My Heart. Before I begin, I want to bless and curse technology. I hate the fact that I have to use this thing in so many ways, and my wife hates it even more. But I use it, right, to keep time, and right now I got the stopwatch running so I don't go too long, because you guys are always mentioning how long church is, and I don't know whether you're serious or not, because you really want to see long church, let's go visit a Baptist church or something, you know. Lutherans are usually a little more succinct. But the reality is, right, it's become so many things for us today that it's, but at the same time, even though I have multiple Bibles on here and a lot of study tools as a pastor, but I still feel so awkward when I'm using it whenever we should be having a Bible, right? And I have my Bible with me whenever I'm preaching. I always prefer to have the Word, even though I print it out often instead, but I have the option to go to it as needed. And I'm so thankful to Dwight and Carrie for providing Bibles in the pews, and I'm going to start making people use them regularly as part of the service soon, because I don't want them to sit there and not get opened. And the reality is we need practice in jumping into the Word. So that's a warning that I'm thinking about things. And when I think about things, sometimes it's scary. So, but technology, right? Like the frustration that my headset hasn't been working lately. But we work around it and we get by it. And I wanted to, all this to lead into the fact that I just wanted to say thank you as well for the fact that Steve can pick one up for me. He knows the right stuff to get. And then that made me think of the fact that I'm thankful that we're blessed, right? Often we go through days and we don't thank people enough, or we aren't as thankful for all the different things around us. But the fact that we have three organists in our church is something that most churches are struggling with, because they don't have organists anymore, or they've entirely jumped ship and they've gone to other instrumental type things. Or we have a violinist that is going to have a child soon, so I'm going to blame that for why you don't play as often as you probably could. And her mother, when she visits, will play for us. I mean, and we have people that play the piano, several of the young ones even in our church. And so just a great, great reality here that we have. There's so many people and so many things that we can be thankful for. And so I get that all out of the way before we start. And I also wanted to mention and remind us that I keep forgetting it, because I think about it when I do my weekly emails. And if you want in on that, there's always time. I can add your email anytime. It seems like I add one every week or two here. And then also on Sunday mornings, I sometimes forget to, because I don't want to belabor it, right? The fact that we're reading through the Bible chronologically as a church. And I've been encouraged by several people who have either made comments related to what they've been reading, which is, I admit, must have been kind of tough. Leviticus is full of all the rules for how to be a priest and what that looked like back then. It's tough, but there's a lot of great things in there that are still special for us that God wants us to hear. So you can skim through things that maybe aren't all that great, but always be looking for how is God speaking to you there. So I want to encourage you, if you have been doing that, continue to do so. Bring any questions you have to the church, and you can ask me, or you can ask other people around you who are probably reading through it as well, hopefully. And if you haven't been, I encourage you to go to grab the reading schedule. There's some back there still. I have a couple in my office yet, or I can print more. And start whenever you can, because it's just a great opportunity we have that we take for granted, right? It sits in our pews in a Bible. We maybe have several of them at home, and how often do we open each one, or how often are we reading it? Or the fact that, you know, you can get literally the Bible at any time, anywhere in the world, on a cell phone, and in any language almost nowadays too, is something we take for granted, and it's ironic. So that really had nothing to do with the sermon, so my apologies. But I wanted to get those thoughts out, because they're important, I think. And today is kind of a special day in the church year. This is the Transfiguration of our Lord, and we'll just jump right into it. After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and he led them up a high mountain by themselves. Now, whenever we see the name John in the Bible, or even James, we often are thinking like, oh yeah, you know, there's several books in the Bible by John, and then James has a book as well, and it's the brother of Jesus. Well, it's not that James and John. This would be the other James and John, the ones that were first called with Peter and his brother Andrew. Andrew is Peter's brother, and they were fishing, And they were fishing with the sons of Zebedee. This is those James and John, the ones that the Bible calls the sons of thunder. Sometimes I feel that way with my sons. But the reality is, right, it's that James and John. And I think sometimes we maybe overlook that because they're not as key of figures in the Bible. But we also see them at a time when they're talking with their mother and they want to talk to Jesus and ask him, like, hey, can we have prominent positions in your kingdom? You know, can we sit at your right and left hand? We see that James and John that are apparently had kind of a high status among the disciples. And we kind of see that here as well, in that Jesus only took these three. I hate to say it this way, as it doesn't really, there's not like this hierarchy of disciples or apostles, but he took like these superior disciples. He took like these three special ones. Peter, who we always think highly of usually, except for when he's denying Christ, which will be coming up soon in Lent. But Peter, James, and John, he took these three. It was a small group. It was a really tight discipleship moment. And he brought them along on what would be a very special situation, a very special thing that nobody else got to see, but we'll all get to see one day. And it was something so special and so unique and so specific to Jesus' reality of who he was and who he is, that he also told them, you can't talk about this until later. And so that can be a hard thing for a lot of us, I'm sure. And so he takes them up on this mountain. They're separated. They're away from reality. They're away from civilization. That's the word I want to say. Pastors have struggles too, right? It's not just when we have to read on Sunday morning or something. And so he takes them up there. And Jesus was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. We may think sometimes when the sun shines in here and it's beaming off my bald forehead, that's bright, right? And that's a white light. But this would be so much more pure, so much more glorious, so much more spectacular, more brighter than when you're driving west into the sunset when the time changes soon. You know, brighter when if you have to drive east and the sun's rising. It'll be brighter than that. In a good brightness, not the kind that burns your retinas out. In a holy and pure righteousness. Oftentimes when this section of Scripture is preached on, you get pastors who will focus on the word transfigured, which means metamorphosis. It's that word in the Greek, and it's the same thing as the caterpillar metamorphosizing into the butterfly, right? And it's still the same creature, but the butterfly is so much more glorious than the caterpillar. Although there are a few caterpillars that look pretty cool, they rarely ever look nearly as elegant and as brilliant as the butterfly. And it's that same word, though. And then, so if that helps you understand what Jesus was doing, here he was, an ordinary guy. He could be sitting in the crowd with us, and he wouldn't stand out as a human being. And he didn't stand out. He often blended into the crowd. He was able to slip away if people didn't know him personally. But at that moment, his glory, he was transformed into his glorious God-man self. And he was greater and unrecognizable from a worldly, ordinary standpoint, and elevated beyond anything we can imagine at this point in our lives. And then what's interesting in verse 3 is that he wasn't by himself. So here we have, and this is a great comfort to us as humans in this world who have yet to face death and what comes after death. But this is a comfort and a reassurance that, you know what, something happens after you die when you're with God. Because here appears Moses and Elijah talking with Jesus. And they also likewise are in their glorified form. They are no longer mere men. They had died hundreds of years before. And yet here they are in existence, recognizable by name and by who they are as individuals in history, as individual creations of God. They were recognizable. For us, that comfort is the fact that if we die in Christ, and we know we're going to be with God, we have that to look forward to. We are still yourselves. I am still Kevin. I am, you know, and you are whoever you are. I don't want to call out names. I get into that habit every week, and I end up picking on Travis all the time, which I just kind of did again. But the reality is our individuality is still there. God knows who we are, and we never cease to lose that. We don't become just a drop of water in the broad existence of nirvana or whatever other false religion you may be looking into. We retain our individuality. And then thankfully, we don't retain our broken, fallen bodies that are decaying, and some of us are further ahead in that process than others. But when, you know, it'll be a perfect form again, and it'll be a glorified form. And so we have that. We can get that from this as well, although that's not the main point of our section of Scripture here. But that's what's so great about Scripture and about how rich it is. And as we read through the Bible, it's that same thing. Even when you're reading through, like in my case, I'm not a big fan of the poetry, right? So that's kind of a struggle for me, but there's great truths of God there. When you're reading through the job descriptions and requirements of the priest, there's still some great reflections there we can draw from. And that's what we're doing as we work through here to get to what is the main point of our section of Scripture. So here we have Jesus glorified in the way he's going to be when everything is made right. And he's joined by Moses and Elijah. And then here's where our human selves come in. You know, we're all Ben Peter, right? You know, maybe you're around a celebrity sometime or somebody that you really are a fan of or you think is, like, super awesome, and you say really, really dumb things. I almost said the wrong word. The girls would have caught me, but I didn't. But you'll say just really ignorant things, right? Because you're, like, so in awe, you don't know what to do. Well, that's what Peter does here, right? You got Jesus in his full God glory, and Peter's like, hey, Lord, it's good that we're here. This is awesome. Can we make a tent for you? And hey, we'll make one for Moses and Elijah too. Like, kind of ridiculous. You don't need a tent at that point. You don't need a shelter. You certainly don't need a shelter from the sun any longer, as you're more glorious than the sun. The rain won't affect you at that point. Nothing can get you down. But Jesus doesn't scold them, and God the Father doesn't scold them either, but he steps in to kind of like, hey, let's not take away from this moment. Let's bring this back to what you need to know. And this is our central and key point of this, as God speaks to them and he speaks to us regarding Jesus Christ, who we read about in our New Testament now. But back then, they were learning under in person. And this is what God says to us from the cloud, very much just like he would have spoken to the Israelites when he spoke in our readings from Exodus, when he was at the mountain and he's given the Ten Commandments and he's making the covenant with the people. And they were terrified because the voice of God and the power of God is terrifying. And so he speaks in a cloud, just like he did there. And the voice from the cloud says, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." So we have three key things there. First of all, he's affirming again, as he did at the baptism of Jesus and elsewhere, where he says, "This is my beloved Son. Jesus Christ is from me. He is me. He is my, not the likeness, but he is the image of God." That's when it says we are a son. When we say somebody is a son, we say they're the image of their father. They not only come from the Father physically, but also in all the ways they act and how who they are, their very being is the same essence as their Father. And that's what he's saying. He's affirming here, "This is my beloved Son. There is no one greater. He is of me. He is me." And then after that, he says, "I am well pleased with him," because Jesus was in his will. He did as he desired. There was nothing wrong with him. There was no fault found in him. He's reaffirming that here, the innocence of Jesus, the perfectness of Jesus, the righteousness of Jesus. That's important, because without that, Easter is meaningless to us. If there is any tiniest little flaw or blemish or insufficiency in Jesus Christ, then there's no hope for us, because then he would not be sufficient to die for me, let alone for everybody throughout history. And so this affirms that from God himself, "I am well pleased with him." And then the last thing is the thing that often maybe in church these days, especially in America, we overlook or we ignore. And it says, "Listen to him." And it's not merely, oh yeah, hear what he says, but it's obey him is what it is. When he speaks to us, when we read the words of Jesus Christ and he says, as we read the last couple weeks, "You are to be salt and light, and you are to love your neighbor and you are to help the poor and the innocent. When he says those things, we're not just oh yeah, that sounds good. Sounds like a good idea. Somebody else can do it. Well, no, it's for each and every one of us. Every one of his creation is supposed to be listening to Jesus Christ, to obey him, to follow his commands. Now, thankfully, that's not what saves us and gets us to be as righteous as Jesus. Not our obedience, but the fact that Jesus was obedient unto death and his resurrection. So it's not a heavy burden for us to bear to listen to him. But when we listen to him, things go well with us because God then, beloved, loves us through Jesus Christ. When he is our Lord in our life and we listen to him more than we listen to the other voices of the world and the voices of men and women in the world who have false ideas, when we listen to him, it's the right way. It's in his will. It pleases him as Jesus pleased him by being in his will. And it makes us his beloved children as well because of Jesus Christ. We could stop there, but there's still some great richness here in the next four verses. And when the disciples heard this, they fell on their faces and they were terrified. Just like the Israelites were just like, Moses, you go talk to God. We aren't worthy here. God's going to kill us and destroy us. They were still terrified, even though it doesn't mention here that there was thunder and lightning and anything like that, like there was in the Exodus. But they were still terrified. The voice of God the Father and his perfection and his righteousness, they're terrifying to us. And that is a burden we can't bear, and we can't stand in his presence. And that reality in that one line is reminding us here of that. We would be no less or no greater than them. We would have been just as terrified. If God's cloud were to come upon here somewhere and speak to us, we would be cowering. I would certainly not be up here on this podium. I would be jumping down and trying to hide in the basement. That's the reality of it. But then, as terrifying as that law aspect is there, you know, God representing the full burden of perfection, and the Ten Commandments are the easiest example of that. The terror of that, the fact that we fail in all of them, is fixed by verse 7 because of Christ. But Jesus came and he touched them, saying, "Rise and have no fear." It's a reminder of Jesus' role in the Trinity, the personality of the Trinity that he is. His purpose is to make everything right, to remove the fear, because he is able to do so. Verse 8, and when they lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. And 9, as they were coming down the mountain, Jesus commanded them, "Tell no one the vision until the Son of Man is raised from the dead." The reality of the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ is what makes it so that we don't have fear. It's what makes it so that when we come here today and we open his word and we worship and we praise him and we listen to the preaching of his word and the teaching of his wisdom through his words, it's what allows us to not have any terror, to not be afraid, because that act is what made us right, because he took the punishment, he took the terror away from us. He took that burden off of us by bearing that for us, which then left us in his righteousness, in his righteous state. And so, if Peter and James and John, after seeing this, had gone out, it wouldn't have been the right time to share that message, because Jesus had not died and been born again yet. Had not died and been raised again. Correction. I misspeak sometimes. Don't do that one wrong. But he died and rose again, making us right, so that the terror of God the Father is not a terror any longer, but it's a restoration of the relationship that we would have. And so our title today is "The Glory of God Was Revealed," or is revealed, and it was God's glory through Jesus Christ. And you see the Father there as well, and the power and the Spirit of truth speaking throughout this passage to us is amazing. And that glory is something that we can't even fully comprehend, but we see it here in this passage. Maybe we enjoy it sometimes when we just drink in the sun on a great, beautiful day that God gives us sometimes. But there are two things I want to say as we wrap this up. The first is that this section of Scripture and the revelation of God and Jesus' glory is a reminder to us that Jesus is worthy to be worshiped by us. He is worthy to be served by us. He is worthy to be praised by us. That he is a Lord who is worthy to be under. And he is a good Lord. He is a good master. And he's like perfect in every way. More perfect than any boss we've ever had, any mother or father we've ever had, any president we've ever had by far. Any elevated authority, he is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and this is the reflection of that. And then the other thing that is our task, this is what we should be doing. He is worthy to be introduced to people, which is the only thing God asks us to do besides loving him. Love him and love others. Well, how do you love others? You introduce them to God. It's not our burden to save them from their sins. It's not our burden to save them from their consequences of their own actions. It's also not our right or responsibility to ridicule them when they make mistakes, which sometimes we fall into. We are there to help them in those times, but to solve their problems and to fix their mistakes of life and to overcome their sins and disobedience to God, only Jesus can do that. And our only responsibility as his servants, as his followers, as those who know him, is to share him with others, to introduce them to him, to bring that relationship to them. And then he works it. The Holy Spirit is what has to work in that person's life. And the wisdom of God from his word has to work in their lives. I can do whatever I want with my kids or my wife or in my household or even in this church. I can say whatever I want. I can say the right thing. I could even say the most perfect thing to each and every one of you that you need to hear. But I can't make you receive it, and I can't make you change your ways. All I can do is come up here, and I can show you and share with you who Jesus is, who God is, who our Creator is, and show you how he is faithful and true, how he knows all things and does all things, believes all things, how he has perfect hope and joy and peace. He has these great things to offer you. And then it's between you and him. And it's on you at that point. It's between you and him. And when you're in that relationship with him, when you know him and he knows you, and it doesn't make you perfect, not until that final day, you'll still screw up. I do every time. I've screwed up several times this morning, I'm sure. I'll screw up more yet, I'm sure, as well. But that doesn't matter because he is correcting and he's rebuking and he's teaching me. And he does that same thing with you. He doesn't give up on you. He's because he cares about you. In the same way, we don't give up with our kids, even though they make noises or they don't do the right thing. Like, they're learning, just as we're learning. And sometimes we're still kids, no matter how old we might be. Al's 90 soon, but he's still learning, aren't you, Al? Right? I know I am. I have a lot more years. I don't know if I'll ever see 90, but God is still working on me, and he can work on you. And he can work on your neighbor who isn't here. Matter of fact, they need it more than anything else. And you have this precious, glorious gift, the revealed Jesus Christ. You have it in his word. You have the fact that you can, wherever you are, whether you're in a tractor or you're in your bed at night, you can call out to him and he hears you. You can thank him and he's there with you. And we take it for granted sometimes, but we need to share that with others who need that introduction. He isn't just our friend, he isn't just our Lord, but he can be their Lord as well. But how can they hear if somebody doesn't take the word to them and speak to them? That's what he calls us to do. So delight this morning in the glory of the Lord and take that to heart. Let that encourage you and build you up. But remember to share that with others. Don't keep it to yourselves. And especially share it with your children and your grandchildren and your spouse every day. That's the foundation that we have in our family lives. We need that. We can't do it on our own strength. But share it with the world, because the world, you read any headline, every single headline is just screaming how the world needs that relationship with the truth. And so share that today. Father, we thank you for your revealed truth. We thank you for the revelation of your glory. And we thank you that you gave us so much instruction and teaching that we can learn no matter what age of life we're in, and stage or season of life. You always have something in your word that speaks to us and instructs us, guides us and directs us, helps us to make the right choices. And we have so many choices each day to make. And we screw up so many of them. But you know what? There's so many that we get right when we walk with you. So help us to do so, Lord. But help us to have a burden for those who don't know you yet, so that we can introduce them to you with joyful hearts and without fear. And to know that if they reject us, that's fine. They're not rejecting us, they're rejecting you. If they hate us for it, that's fine. We don't need people to love us because you love us. And that's all that matters. We lift these things up in the name of Jesus Christ, your glorious Son. Amen. We continue with our closing hymn, I Love to Tell the Story.
Thank you.
We continue with prayer to our Father. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our benediction today I take from the book of Jude, the last two verses. Jude writes to us on God's behalf, "Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, and now and forever. Amen."